The primary role of iron is to carry oxygen in the blood to every cell in the body. That's its most important job. And we all need iron to make hemoglobin, which is a protein in red blood cells that carries oxygen from the lungs and the rest of the body. If your body doesn't have enough iron, it can't produce enough healthy oxygen-carrying red blood cells, and iron deficiency can later on cause anemia, which means you have too little hemoglobin. There's also iron deficiency without anemia too that we can explore. And in this video, we will look at 7 signs of having low iron and why it's important to get these levels measured, so stay with me till the end. Also, real quick before we get started, it would mean the world to me if you hit the like button down below for the YouTube algorithm and turn the bell on next to it to stay up to date with new weekly videos. Now, in order to paint the picture clearly, let's talk about the causes of low iron. Where did all the iron go, right? What happened to it? The first explanation could be simple, like blood loss. This includes GI bleeding, menstrual bleeding, or sometimes just injury. Sometimes it could also be that you're a frequent blood donor too. Secondly, a lack of iron in your diet from not eating meats and leafy greens. Heme iron is found only in animal flesh like meat, poultry, and seafood. And non-heme iron is found in plant foods like whole grains, nuts, seeds, legumes, and leafy greens. Heme iron is better absorbed by the body than non-heme iron, but plant-based eaters can still meet their daily iron needs by eating plenty of non-heme-rich plant foods. Vitamin C actually raises the levels of non-heme iron, which is why you've heard to drink orange juice with your supplements. But oftentimes, vegans and vegetarians, especially if they're also women, are more prone to iron deficiency. The third reason could be that maybe you have enough iron in your diet, but your body has a hard time absorbing it, such as in gastric bypass surgery. Fourth, it could be that you're pregnant or recently given birth, which is why it's a good idea to see this visual summary of how much iron you really need. Notice how after 51 years of age for women, that number drops from 18 all the way down to 8. But with that said, if you're still having menstrual cycles after 50, you may still need the same amount of iron as someone who is 19 to 49, so keep that in mind. Now let's move on to the 7 signs. The first sign of low iron is hair loss. This is because our hair strands need oxygen to grow and stay on your head. Having low iron affects your hemoglobin, which affects how much oxygen your cells carry. Now, if you're losing about 50 to 100 hairs per day, that's normal, but anything above that may be related back to your iron levels. It is a condition known as telogen effluvium, which basically means your hair will shed, but it will also stall. How does that make sense? You see, about 10-15% of our hair follicles are in the telogen phase, the resting phase, right? But iron deficiency can push our hair follicles into the telogen phase for longer. When this happens, hair follicles will rest and at the same time hair falls out but doesn't grow back in. This is why you get hair thinning that looks more noticeable. So that's the first sign. The second sign is pica, having a strange craving for non-edible foods like crayons, dirt, chalk, and ice cubes. These are just a few examples. Then there are other stranger cravings like coins, burnt matches, and even soap. Oftentimes these cravings come with not just having low iron, but low hematocrit and low hemoglobin. And we aren't too sure why this occurs, but it is believed by some to be a way that the body is actually trying to replace missing nutrients it desperately needs. Let your doctor know right away if you have cravings for non-edible foods. Usually when correcting the iron, these cravings go away on their own, which is good. The third sign is pale skin. You see, when red blood cells become low in iron, they become smaller and paler in the center, and so does the skin. But this can be harder to notice in people with darker skin tones, right? So a secondary way this could be tested is if you pull your lower eyelid down while looking in a mirror, the inside layer should be red. If it's very pale pink or yellow, you may be low in iron. The fourth sign is cold hands and feet, which happens when your body prioritizes using oxygen for vital organs instead, leaving your extremities behind. And also, if you're not getting enough oxygen into your tissues, you don't have a normal sensation of what's hot and cold, right? Another interesting explanation for this is how we all need iron for a healthy thyroid, right? When there's a lack of iron, this affects how our thyroid hormones regulate our body temperature. But keep in mind, having cold hands and feet could be related back to other conditions too, not just having low iron. Raynaud's syndrome, an underactive thyroid, peripheral artery disease, diabetes, and just having poor circulation can all be causes of cold hands and feet as well. The fifth sign of having low iron is seeing nail changes. In the beginning, your nails can be brittle and chip easily. Then later on, they can become spoon-shaped like this. Each nail has a dent large enough to hold a drop of water in a condition known as coelonychia. Now, brittle nails can be a result of many other conditions like aging, Raynaud's syndrome, low thyroid, and chemo, so keep that in mind too. The sign that gives it away is the spooning of the nail though. The nails start out flat, then eventually an indentation forms, almost like the opposite of nail clubbing. The sixth sign is shortness of breath, and this is seen more with iron deficiency anemia. Now, there are three major branches of anemia that you should know of. While all of these versions affect the red blood cell count, the causes and symptoms for each are going to vary. Both acute and chronic forms of anemia can lead to shortness of breath. This is because the body exchanges carbon dioxide for oxygen in a very precise and balanced manner, right? For this balance to keep occurring efficiently, you need enough red blood cells circulating to keep this steady state going. And it's natural for shortness of breath to creep in more when you lay down for bed. This is because now you're putting additional pressure on your diaphragm, making you put extra work to get a normal breath in and out. This is definitely a symptom that you should never ignore. Bring this up to your doctor right away. And lastly, the seventh sign, rapid and irregular heartbeats. Low levels of iron also make the heart work harder to deliver oxygen to the bloodstream. And whenever the heart has to work harder, you get an elevated pulse, and with that can come heart palpitations. If you have this symptom, you should consult your doctor as well. But what about testing? The testing for confirmation should include a complete blood count or a CBC. Sometimes that's not the whole picture though. Additional tests like serum ferritin, iron, total iron binding capacity, and transferrin are important tests for more clarity. It's important to have this data before you start supplementing so you can get an actual timeline of your progress and see how the supplements are working. And there are many types of iron supplements out there that can help raise your iron levels. Two of the most common ones are your ferrous sulfate and ferrous gluconate. The amount of iron prescribed by your doctor will be in milligrams of elemental iron. For ferrous sulfate, 325 milligrams, this equates to 65 milligrams of elemental iron. Whatever version of iron supplements you take, I wanted to leave you guys with 8 tips to help you make the most out of them. 1, iron is absorbed best on an empty stomach, but sometimes they can make it upset. So if that's you, take a small amount of food to avoid this problem, just nothing spicy or rich. 2, avoid milk and dairy products 2 hours before and 2 hours after to avoid calcium interfering in the way of absorption. 3, same goes for your calcium supplements, high fiber foods, kombucha, coffee, tea, and even antacids like Tums. 4, drink an 8-ounce glass of orange juice with it to increase non-heme iron absorption. 5, if your stool color changes to green or dark black, not to worry as this is normal. 6, there's some evidence for better absorption if you take iron every other day versus every day. 7, avoid the EC coated versions or slow release iron supplements as their absorption can be lower. And 8, get your labs checked twice a year to see if you're on the right track. But I'm more curious to hear from you guys. What are your thoughts on iron and iron deficiency? Leave me them in the comments below. If you found this video helpful, give it a like. And until then, guys, I'll see you on the next one.